Good morning. I thought maybe this wasn't Hilo because it wasn't raining when my plane landed this morning. I thought, did we go to a different island? It's always a pleasure to be back on the Big Island. As Reverend Nakamura said, my wife and I have written a guidebook to Buddhist temples, Japanese Buddhist temples in Hawaii. And we took 3 years to visit all of the Japanese Buddhist temples in Hawaii. And there are 90 Buddhist temples in the whole state. In the old days, it used to be about 150, but you know, still 90. That's quite a few temples. So we had kind of a system, you know, we'd send a letter out, make the arrangement to go and visit a particular temple and meet with the minister, meet with lay members, and having visited all of the islands, all of the Japanese Buddhist temples, I can say with absolute accuracy that the best hospitality we received was on the Big Island. Amazing. We had a schedule. 9 o'clock, our first temple. The second temple, we did 3 temples a day. When we came to the Big Island, and you know, we would stay for about a week, and so we're staying at a hotel. At first, we would have breakfast, and then we'd go out. But then when we got to the first temple, you know, all of the temples, all of your temples, provided food, like this huge spread of food. And we soon learned not to eat breakfast at the hotel because we're going to get fed 3 times a day before dinner. In fact, I remember one temple where, you know, we got there at 9 o'clock in the morning. People were there, met them, introduced ourselves. Come eat. And this old temple member comes up and said, "Hey, you like one beer?" I said, "Bro, it's 9 o'clock. I know, you like one beer." Okay. So you know, I had beer at 9 in the morning, so you know, it proved that people on the Big Island, they know how to live and how to enjoy themselves. I actually have a title to my talk. It's called The Humanism of Kobodashi. And I'll explain what humanism means. But all of my comments are to be set in the larger context of what concern that we all have, and today in the afternoon, you're going to be talking about the future of the temples here in Hawaii. And we all know, and we've all been dealing with this for many, many years now, that it's a struggle. It's hard. Temple membership is down, members are getting older, and younger people are not coming in. So the very future of the temples are at stake. And so it's within this larger context that I would like to give some of my comments specifically about what we can learn from Kobodashi. But let me just throw out a few sort of, you know, facts and set this larger context of what the future of Buddhism is, not only in Hawaii, but also in America or in the West. We live in a really interesting time because there are two trends that are opposite, but they're going on at the same time in terms of Buddhism. So when we look at temple membership, you know, we see it going down very clearly. All the temples. And by the way, it's not just Buddhist temples. You know, the Christian churches are also experiencing the same kind of decline. Institutional religion as a whole is having a very difficult time in the America of our modern times. Things change. You know, how it was back when the first missionaries came over is very different from how it is now. What the cultural and religious situation was for my grandfather when he came to Hawaii in 1898. Very different for my father, he's Nisei, I'm Sansei, my son is Yonsei, my grandsons are Gosei. And so, you know, times go on. And, you know, I talk to my grandsons and, you know, I kind of wonder, these Tanabe family kids, I mean, you know, they're so different. They're different. And that's how it should be. I mean, you know, time shift, we all have experienced that. And we all have seen the differences between the generations. Look at my son, I wonder, you know, this guy, my kid, the way how he raises his kid, and his wife, mom. Boy, tell you, they cannot go outside. Put on sunscreen. Okay, put on sunscreen. You know all these stories, right? Put on sunscreen and all of this. And, you know, they're really strict. Really strict. And I look at my childhood. You know, my parents never knew where we were. We're down by the river, we're swimming, we're shooting BB guns at each other. You know, now it's so regulated and regimented and all kinds of rules and regulations about what to eat, what to do, all of this, you know, very, very, very different. But again, that's how it should be. You know, times change. And so the real challenge for us is in terms of the temples, how are we going to meet the changing times? And now temples, like churches, are very good at preserving the past, preserving traditions, doing the chants today, just like Grandpa did it, just like great-great-grandpa did it way back then. You know, there's a kind of continuity. That's a beautiful thing, to have that kind of tradition continue. The challenge is that the society and the culture changes, and therefore, some of those old things don't really resonate with the younger generation. And so, we want to sort of keep this whole context of change and the modern society that we live in when we talk about what can we do to preserve or to make sure that there is a future for the temples. So the first trend, as I said, is declining temple membership. The other trend, which is really fascinating for our country, and this is a nationwide trend, is that one of the fastest growing religions in America is, guess what? It's Buddhism. But it's not temple Buddhism. You know, it's the kind of Buddhism that people, by the millions, literally, are embracing. Meditation, you're going to be doing some meditation this afternoon or right after this. Meditation. The ideas of Buddhism, the teachings of Buddhism. That's what is really popular. See, what's not popular is ritual. And that's what we find in temple Buddhism. Temple Buddhism is based on ritual. And that's the kind of Buddhism that is not resonating with younger generations. But the kind of practice, as opposed to ritual, a practice, personal practice, like meditation, or reading about Buddhism, learning about the teachings of Buddhism, ideas about interdependence, ideas about compassion, those kinds of very old and traditional Buddhist ideas are really, really popular. And so Buddhism is, on that kind of Buddhism, non-temple Buddhism, is really on the rise. The Pew Research Center keeps track of the statistics, the temple membership, amongst other kinds of demographic information. But the Pew Research Center's latest study shows that at the current rate of the increase of interest amongst Americans in Buddhism, at the current rate of increase, by the year 2050, which is not that far away from our time now, the number of Buddhists in America is going to double. In other words, it's growing. We look at our temples and it's dying, but we look at this other kind of Buddhism and it's booming. It's really growing. Here in Hawaii, when my wife and I did our temple guidebook, because we visited every temple, we carried out a study that had never been done before, which is to count the number of members at temples. And so we have a very good number, because every temple we visited would say, how many members do you have, how many families, and so on. And it's still an estimate, but by our estimate, there are 20,000 temple members in the state of Hawaii, Buddhist temple members in the state of Hawaii. That's covering all of the denominations, okay? 20,000. The Pew Research Center, when they come to Hawaii, they come to go to all of the other states and ask people, you know, what's your religion? You know, how do you identify yourself in terms of religion? Not what temple or church do you belong to, but you know, how do you identify yourself? What do you think of yourself as religiously? And the number of people in Hawaii, in our state, who identify themselves as Buddhist, 90,000. 20,000 temple members, 90,000 people, they're our neighbors, who consider themselves to be Buddhists, even though they're not going to temples. So when we think about, you know, how can we expand, how can we grow, it's not just a question of can we reach out to people who are not Buddhists and to, you know, bring them into the Buddhist community. There already is a very large Buddhist community right here in our backyard. 90,000 people in our state identify themselves as being Buddhist, and this number is growing. So once again, we see this, you know, decline and rise of different kinds of Buddhism. And so the question becomes, how can we sort of adapt? How can we change? How can we take our traditions and to modify them, to massage them, to sort of come up with some different approaches so that we can reach out not only to people who do not consider themselves to be Buddhist, but people who already call themselves Buddhist, but they're not going to temples. So, in a certain sense, there's a kind of a real positive opportunity. You know, it's not all doom and gloom. You know, there's a real opportunity if we can somehow tap into this very large part of our community that already exists. Since I retired from the University of Hawaii 100 years ago, seems like it. And you know, you always didn't give me a certificate in a little bag when I left. I don't know, you always really cheap, right? At any rate, so I've been working for an organization called Bukkyo Dendo Kyokai, DDK. I think you're all familiar with it. We're the ones who distribute that orange book, The Teaching of Buddha, you know, at all the temples and at all the hotels and so on. So this is an organization that's headquartered in Japan, in Tokyo, but it has branches all over the world, really. And I head the BDK Hawaii, but I also am now the chairman of BDK America, which is located in Berkeley. BDK America, we do the same thing, pass on these books about Buddhism. But we also have an amazing project of translation. And so we translate the Buddhist scriptures, the Buddhist sutras, into English, and creating a kind of a collection of Buddhist sutras. Now, you know, if you're a Christian, your scripture is the New Testament. It's about this big. If you're Jewish, the Hebrew Bible is about this big. If you're Muslim, the Quran is about this big. If you're Buddhist, the books are, I don't know, maybe from Abhishekha Sensei to me right here. 85 volumes in dense Chinese. Each volume 1,000 pages long. And BDK, our organization, we are committed to this really slightly insane idea. We're going to translate some of this into English. So I calculated that if we ever get this done, the translations will number 1,200 volumes of English. 1,200 volumes. That's how many books it would take to translate the Buddhist scriptures in the Chinese collection. And these are already translations from Sanskrit and Pali and other Buddhist canonical languages. And so, you know, Buddhists have been writing, you know, for centuries. And they produce a tremendous amount of literature, tremendous amount of commentaries, sutras, and essays. And the Buddhist collection, therefore, is very, very large. 1,200 volumes. So BDK, we've been translating for about 35 years now. And this year, we published volume 54. We've got a long ways to go yet. A huge, huge thing. Now, if any of you have tried reading Buddhist sutras, you know how hard it is. Even the short sutra that we chanted, the Heart Sutra. You know, ever tried to read the translation of it? It's pretty hard. See, all the ministers are the first ones to agree, you know. But you know, I'll tell you a secret. They don't know what it means to them. Form is emptiness, emptiness is form. What does that mean? You know, it's hard stuff. It's really hard. But when you look at Buddhist literature, it's like a treasury. It's got an amazing collection of all kinds of ideas. Who are we? What is the structure of the mind? How do emotions work? You know, these are all very human questions, but they're put in very philosophical, metaphysical language, and it's very, very hard to understand. When Buddhism was introduced to Japan from Korea, one of the kings of Korea sent a Buddhist statue to the Japanese court. This is in the 6th century AD, and sent some Buddhist sutras. And the king of Korea wrote a letter, which we still have, and he recommended Buddhism to the Japanese, and he said, you know, this is a great religion. You know, this is the religion of the mainland, you know, of the great civilization of China. And you island boys out there, you should think about adopting this mainland religion. It's really great. There are two reasons why it's great. Number one, it's very powerful, and it can fulfill all of your desires. Which is a really interesting thing for the king of Korea to have said, because you might remember that at the beginning of Buddhism with Shakyamuni in India, that in the Four Noble Truths, you know, you have to put an end to desire. But see how the Buddhism has changed? The Buddhism that is coming into Japan is not the Buddhism of Shakyamuni. I mean, historically, that's just a fact. It's not the Buddhism of Shakyamuni. It's very different. The reason why Buddhism has lasted for so long. The reason why Buddhism has gone from one country to another country. The reason why Buddhism has become a world religion, and again, still very popular, booming in America, is because it changed. And of course, we remember that that's one of the basic teachings of early Buddhism. Shakyamuni Buddha said, everything changes. Everything changes. And if you take my teaching, Shakyamuni said, and you use it like a raft, and you go from this shore to the other shore, when you get to the other shore, the last thing you want to do is to pick up that raft of my teaching, put it on your back, and carry it around. No, let it go. And the reason why there are so many sutras, why Buddhist scriptures are so voluminous, is because these texts are being written over many, many centuries, and the people, Buddhists who are writing these texts, are coming up with new ideas, all kinds of new ideas. as Buddhist scholars in Japan from, you know, medieval times have noticed, looking at all of these scriptures, reading through as much of it as you can, you know, their observation was, if this set of ideas and teachings came from one man, Shakyamuni, Shakyamuni must have been very confused, because it's so diverse, there's so many contradictions, there's so many different interpretations, which is why there are so many different denominations of Buddhism. So the great strength of Buddhism is that it has changed. It has changed. It has adopted and adapted itself. India, it's Indian Buddhism. It goes to China, what does it become? Chinese Buddhism. Early on, the Chinese Buddhists go to India to learn, but after a while, after it becomes Chinese, they train and they ordain their own priest. Goes to Korea, goes to Japan. Chinese Buddhism goes to Japan. And for a while, like Kobodaishi, you go to China to learn your Buddhism. But that's in the early period. Afterwards, nowadays, Japanese priests don't go to China to train. Why? Because Chinese Buddhism became Japanese Buddhism. So Indian Buddhism became Chinese Buddhism. Chinese Buddhism became Japanese Buddhism. Japanese Buddhism now comes to Hawaii, America. And how do we identify it? As Japanese Buddhism. See, we don't have Hawaiian Buddhism yet. That's the challenge. We need to create our own Hawaiian Buddhism. Just like the Japanese created Japanese Buddhism. Just like the Chinese created Chinese Buddhism. It changes. And the teaching of Shakyamuni is not the teaching that we find in later forms of Buddhism, because they changed the teaching to make it suitable for themselves. And so this is the challenge. We need to create a Hawaiian Buddhism. We need to create an American Buddhism. Now there is something called American Buddhism. Scholars who study Buddhism recognize that there is an American Buddhism. And the numbers of people who consider themselves American Buddhists, these are the, you know, like the 90,000 here in Hawaii. There is a form of Buddhism that is called American Buddhism. And again, it's not tied to temples. They are small groups that are studying, that are practicing, that are making sense of Buddhism. Buddhism, again, is very, very popular. At BDK, we've been translating these sutras, these scriptures, very hard to read stuff, but really fascinating kind of ideas. If you take the trouble and the time to read it. Oh, I was going to say, I forgot the second thing the King of Korea said. You know, why is Buddhism a good religion? It's very powerful. It can satisfy all your desires. The second reason why you should adopt Buddhism is because it's very profound. Very profound. And to show you how profound this religion is, I'm sending you some sutras. And I want you to read it. And you're going to read it and you're not going to understand it. That's how profound it is. So that's the definition of profundity, right? You read something, you go, whoa, I don't get this, you know. God, I must be stupid. This guy, whoever wrote this must be pretty smart, but I don't get it. So, you know, the Buddhist texts are known for being very profound, which means very difficult to understand. The amazing thing about these translations that BDK is putting out, you know, we publish them. You know, we have a international network of scholars who are, you know, translating these very difficult texts. Only a handful of people can do this kind of work, but it's really technical stuff, really hard stuff. And when we publish it with this, you know, nice hardback books. They're quite expensive. They range from $40 to $80. Some of them like $100. I mean, you know, it's expensive. Books these days, you know, paper, hardback books are very expensive. And even though they are hard to read and they're expensive, I'm always amazed. Every month I get the report, you know, how many books did we sell, you know? And every month we sell about, you know, 100 copies. Now that's not a real huge number, but when you think about what kind of book this is, the question I always have when I look at those numbers, who are these 100 people buying these books? I mean, you know, this is hard stuff, it's expensive. You gotta be serious if you're gonna be buying a book like this, spending that kind of money, spending that kind of time and effort to try to understand what these ideas are. Well, a year ago, we decided, at BDK America, we decided to make these books available as free PDF downloads. Now, here's the other thing that we need to think about. You know, we live in an electronic age. We live in an age of the internet and so on. Are we making use of that kind of technology to promote and to advance our temples and Buddhism? I think Reverend Finch is doing some interesting stuff along the lines of using modern technology in order to get the word out. So we decided to take the PDF files that we have, which is what we use to print. You know, nowadays printers just take a PDF file. And if you don't know what PDF is, there's the problem. it's a form of having a text file that has become standard in publishing. So if you want to publish a book, you know, you write your manuscript, you convert it to a PDF file, and then you send it to the publisher, and then they use that file to print it. Well, PDF files can also be uploaded to a website, and you can download it very easily. And so you can, you know, just download. And we offer it on the BDK America website for free. So, you know, we put on our website, you can buy the book for $80, or you can download it for free. And we thought, well, that's a good service. I mean, we're a service organization. You know, we want to promote Buddhism. We're not out to make money. We have to charge money for the hardbacks because it's expensive to print those books, to publish those books. But PDFs don't cost any money once you produce the PDF. You know, you upload it to your website, you put a notice out there, and you tell people, go to our website, click on this button, and you can download the Buddhist scripture for free. Well, February of last year, 2017, was the first month that we made these Buddhist scriptures available for free as a PDF download. 4,000 downloads in February. They're like, whoa. Boy, who's reading this stuff? Next month comes, 3,000 downloads. The next month comes. It's been going like 2,000 to 6,000 downloads a month. And today, the last I checked, not too long ago, though we've been doing this for a little over a year, there have been 50,000 downloads of Buddhist texts. And the only lesson I can draw from this is that there is a hunger out there for materials like this, Buddhist literature like this, Buddhist ideas, Buddhist philosophy. There's a market, to put it in business terms, there's a market out there, and people are hungry. They're hungry for, and this is the word that, you know, I keep hearing over and over from younger people. And the word is, you might keep this one word in mind as you think about, you know, planning strategies for the future, and that word is meaning. Not just what is the meaning of my life, what's the meaning of this book? What does some text have to say to me that I can use in my life. And I can say, you know, this is a great idea. This is a fantastic idea. And obviously, there are thousands of people out there who are finding meaning in Buddhist texts. 50,000 downloads and counting, 4,000 every month, you know, just growing. It's a very popular religion. People really want to learn about Buddhism, and they want to learn, and they are downloading these books, buying these books, and that's because there is great meaning in these works, and people find it very useful. See, that's very different. If I think of my grandfather, who was a very devout Buddhist, like I think most of the Issei were, the people that Reverend Hashimoto studied. And by the way, that is such a great book that you wrote. You know, it's the best history of Shingon in Hawaii. I use it all the time. It's a great history of Shingon, the only history of Shingon in Hawaii. And if I think of my grandfather, a very devout, Honganji Buddhist, you know, Namantavas, you know, all the time. Yeah. But I remember when I was in college, and you know, I started to become interested in religion and in Buddhism, and my grandfather was still alive, I went, "Grandpa, what is Jodo Shinshu teaching? What is Honganji teaching?" He looked at me like, "You want me to explain the teaching? You want me to explain the meaning of this religion?" And in effect, you know, he was saying, "Boy, you don't know what religion is. Religion is just something you do. Religion is not something you understand." And for that generation, it worked perfectly. You just do it. You just do it. You chant the chant. What does it mean? I don't know. But you chant the chant. You know, you go to a funeral, you're going to hear about that. You know, what does it mean? I don't know. But every time somebody dies, you have a Buddhist funeral. By the way, it's not just true in Hawaii, or, you know, it's true in Japan too. You know, ask young Japanese who consider themselves Buddhists, you know, what's the teaching of? What's the teaching of teaching that Buddha? What's the teaching of Shingon? What's the teaching of Honpa Honganji and so on? You know, explain to me, tell me, what does it mean? And see, for my generation, third generation, most of us, I guess, in here, or fourth generation, we're kind of in between. You know, we still have enough of that old-fashioned style of practicing religion, which you just do it. You don't have to understand it, you just do it. You know, here's what you say. And so we say it. But we don't know what it means. But I tell you, when it comes to my son's generation, fourth generation, they're not interested in just doing it because that's how we always did it. They want to know what it means. At my father's funeral, when all my nieces and nephews came from the mainland for the funeral, and you know, it was held at the Waigo Honganji, and the minister came and they did, you know, all the chanting. And then the minister got up and he gave a little sermon in English. And after it was over, my nieces and nephews, all college educated, like all of our kids are pretty much, you know, all intelligent people. You know, they came up, Uncle, what did that service mean?" See, that's their first question. What did it mean? Well, I spent my whole life studying it, so I can say, "Okay, sit down, kids. Let me tell you what this means." You know, I can go going through it, you know. But the really interesting thing was, they said, "And what did the minister really say?" I said, "You heard it. He spoke in English. You didn't get what he said?" "We had no idea. It made no sense. You know, it was just, blah, 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 you know, it just made no sense." I think we've all had that experience of, you know, hearing sermons, or lectures for that matter. Professors are like that too. You know, you go hear a nice talk and go, oh, what is this guy saying? It made no sense. And see, what is that telling us? They want to understand what the meaning is. They want to understand what this means. It's not just a question of sit down, chant, and that's it. You know, so the ritual is no longer appealing to the younger generation. For us old folks, you know, it still has a lot of significance, even if we don't know what the meaning is. You know, it feels good to chant the chant. But the young kids are not there. This is why they're not coming to the temples, because when they go to the temples, they sit there, they have no idea what's going on. They don't know what the minister is saying. They don't get it. And we expect them to come back. No, they're not going to come back. You know, they're going to leave. They're going to go to some Christian church where they understand everything that's going on. They understand, and there is meaning in what is being said. So this is a great challenge for us, for the temple. It's a meaning. You know, what does it mean? And can we explain it to our kids? Can we explain it to our neighbors? Oh, you Shingon Buddhist? Oh, you know. Well, hey, what is Shingon Buddhism? Explain to me. Tell me. What does it mean? See, and we have a hard time doing that. And, you know, it doesn't work well in our time. Like I said, generations change. My grandfather's generation, no problem with that approach. But it doesn't work anymore. Now, when we look at the history of Buddhism, and are we going to go straight through to 12? Should we take a break, or should I just tell people, if you got to go, go?
Maybe during the next portion of the, we show the first part of the movie, and then we will break.
Okay.
And all right. Question and answers.
Yeah. Okay. What was I saying?
Future.
Yeah, probably getting old. Yeah. Can't remember anything. There are two points. I go to number one and forget number two. Change. So, how old is Buddhism? It's about 2,500 years old. Yeah, it's one of the oldest religions around, and so it's been through a lot of change. But one of the ways of looking, a simple way of looking at the difference between the early Buddhism, Shakyamuni, and the later what we call Mahayana Buddhism, which developed 500, 600 years after Shakyamuni, and then continued to develop. And in Japan, you know, the forms of Buddhism that we have in Japan all developed, you know, arose in Japan. You know, Tendai with Saicho, Shingon with Kukai, Jōshinshu with Shinran, Soto Zen with Dōgen, Nichiren, so on. All the forms of Buddhism that we are familiar with in terms of Japanese tradition, you know, arose, what, 1,000 years after Shakyamuni. So here's the difference between early Buddhism, Shakyamuni Buddhism, and later Mahayana Buddhism. And I'm going to oversimplify. The early Buddhism of Shakyamuni is not based on ritual. And it's very easy to understand. You know, we can take a book like the Dhammapada, which takes the sayings of the Buddha, the early Buddhism. And you read a book like this, and there's no forms, emptiness is form. You know, the very famous passage from the Dhammapada. Hatred is not solved by hatred. only love can solve the problem of hatred. Totally straightforward, universal, understandable in any country, in any time. You know, it's one of these sort of universal rules. This is the teaching of Shakyamuni. Here's another one. Don't speak harshly to anyone. What you say will be said back to you. Hostile speech is painful, and you will meet with retaliation. Any problem understanding that? No, pretty straightforward. We should tell that to some of our politicians. Hostile speech is painful. But this is true just in terms of our ordinary relationship with people. So, it just goes on and on. I mean, a whole book filled with, you know, very, very simple kinds of, but here it is, hatred never ends through hatred, by non-hate or love alone does it end. This is an ancient truth. Many do not realize that we here must die. For those who realize this, arguments end. Fascinating stuff, really interesting stuff, right? I mean, you know, you can relate to that, you can understand that, you can tell this to your kids, and so on. So I want to, I've been promoting this book in all of my talks recently. This book here, which has a very interesting title called The Things You Can See Only When You Slow Down. Things You Can See Only When You Slow Down. It's written by a Korean Zen monk named Sunim, a BDK. We brought him over last year. He gave a talk at the Hawaii Book and Music Festival, which was held in Honolulu. And he wrote this book in Korean, of course. And in Korea, it sold 3 million copies. 3 million copies. His royalties were about $2 a book. He made $6 million on this book. Yeah. So, how come this book, written by a Buddhist monk, became so popular in Korea, and now it's been translated only about a year ago, so this is a kind of a new translation, been translated into English. Why is it so popular? Well, let me read you a passage, right? Tell me if it's hard for you to understand or not. Well, maybe it will be, because this is geared for younger people. Because it starts off when you are dating. Anybody here dating? Then this doesn't apply to you, sorry. But if you're telling it to your kids or your grandkids, and you can read it to them, you know, when you are dating, temper your enthusiasm. You may ask, what is wrong with expressing my honest feelings? Why can't I give her, this is obviously written from the male point of view, why can't I give her a gift and tell her I love her? Your words and gifts will mean more to her when she is ready. Love her, not your feelings. Yeah. You know, I don't know. There's no, you know, complication in this. It's just very straightforward, and it's very easy to understand. And he goes on. He has whole chapters on love and dating. Now, when was the last time in a Buddhist temple you ever talked about love and dating? And then you ask yourself, why aren't the young people here? This is what they want to hear. They want to hear about stuff that relates to that. They want to hear about the issues that are big in their lives. I was asked to give a talk once at a retreat of high school Buddhist, you know, kids. And they organized the retreat. They invited me. I asked them, I said, "Oh, what do you want me to talk about?" He said, "We want you to talk about Buddhism and sex." Oh, what am I going to say? I work something up, so I go to the retreat, and one of the ministers, he comes up, and he apologizes. "Oh, Professor Fernando, I'm sorry. I said, "What are you sorry about?" "Well, I'm sorry the kids asked you to talk about Buddhism and sex." I said, "Yeah, it's kind of a hard topic, but I'll do my best." He said, "You know, I have to explain. The kids organized this retreat. Now, if we ministers organize it, we would never ask you to talk about Buddhism and sex." So I said, "Sensei, good thing you didn't organize it. Because you know what? The topics you would have come up with, the kids are not interested in." When was the last time we asked young people, kind of too late now, but they're not there in the temple, but when was the last time we asked younger people, "What are your questions about Buddhism?" Well, here, it's about dating, it's about love, it's about romance, it's about feeling depressed, it's about, you know, having a hard time with your friends, all the kinds of issues that young people, and even older people for that matter, are really interested in. But this is one passage where I'm going to paraphrase it. It says something like, "Are you a helicopter parent?" You know, that what we were talking about before, you know, people on your sunscreen, we're just watching all the time. "Are you a helicopter parent? Are you paying too much attention to your children? Turn that attention and care to your parents, and your children will learn how to treat you." Yeah? Interesting. I emailed it to my son. To this day, no answer. But that's the kind of, you know, and it's all in here. This is a Buddhist book. This is a Buddhist book. And it reminds me, and I told him in this, I said, "You know, this book is the modern Dhammapada. This is like 2,500 years old. This is like, you know, 2 years old. But it's the same kind of writing. A, easy to understand. B, relates to my life. You know, relates to my life." All right? So, early Buddhism is easy to understand, and it relates to everyday life. In early Buddhism, in the Buddhism of Shakyamuni, there are no gods, there are no divine beings. There's no Amida, there's no Dainichi, there's no Kanto, there's no Fudo. All those are later Mahayana developed. So why did Mahayana Buddhism develop then later? Well, it developed later because this early Buddhism, you know, easy to understand as it was actually hard to practice. You know, like I said, this really nice piece of advice to my son. You think he's going to follow it? No. Hatred is not solved by hatred. Only love can solve hatred. Are you going to love your enemies? No. You know, it's hard. Easy to understand, but hard to practice. And so, realizing that it's very difficult to live the kind of moral life that the Dhammapada is calling for, you know, I have to be compassionate, I have to care about people, I have to not hate, I have to not get angry, you know, all of that. I have to be very disciplined about myself. And remember that in early Buddhism, you know, to become a monk or a nun meant that you would follow very strict rules about what you eat, what you speak, what you wear, you can't get married, you can't have sex, you know, all of that. Very severe kinds of rules. It's a kind of a difficult thing to put into practice. Easy to understand, but very difficult to put into practice. So Mahayana Buddhism developed because people began to feel that having to do everything by myself, you know, I have to be without hatred. I have to be compassionate. I have to be without desire. I can't do it. It's just too hard. That kind of moral perfection is just too hard for me to put into practice in my everyday life. And so I'm going to die with bad karma. The goal of Buddhism, early Buddhism, was to get rid of bad karma. How do you get rid of bad karma? By acting morally, by creating good karma in your action. You have bad karma because you lie? Don't tell a lie. You have bad karma because you get angry? Don't get angry. And on and on and on. Well, it's pretty hard, you know, not get angry, not lie. I mean, you know, these are things that, you know, we do all the time. And therefore, we cannot get rid of our bad karma. So we die, and then early Buddhism teaches your next life, you keep working at it. Try to decrease your bad karma. Another life of failure, you die, your next life, you keep working at it. And so in early Buddhism, it was said that life after life after life, you have to keep working on getting rid of your bad karma. How do you get rid of your bad karma? You have to perform acts of good. Who gets rid of your bad karma? You do. The responsibility is all on your own shoulders. And people began to realize that, you know, this is impossible. I'm not going to be able to be morally perfect. That is not possible. Isn't there another way that we can get rid of bad karma? And the Mahayana answer to that is yes, there is another way. Call on the Buddhas. Perform ritual. And that's how you get rid of bad karma. And so even if you have bad karma, you can become a Buddha. Even if you have bad karma, you can be reborn in the Pure Land. That is revolutionary. Why? You mean I'm not morally perfect, but, you know, I can become a Buddha? The original definition of Buddha was one who had no bad karma. And now you're saying I can become a Buddha because I have bad karma? Now, how does that happen? Call on the greater power. Call on the mysterious power. We don't know how it works. We don't understand the mechanics of how it is that these Buddhas and Bodhisattvas have such power that they can cancel out our bad karma. Yeah, and so all the Mahayana Buddhist rituals are designed for, you know, metazai, to destroy bad karma. Who destroys the bad karma? The greater powers that we call upon. I don't. I'm just a mortal, infallible, weak, imperfect human being. And I can't do it myself. And that's why I call upon the greater powers. And I call upon them through ritual. Alright? So now we read the Mahayana scriptures. And really hard to understand. Because it's maybe not possible to explain in logical, rational terms, how these greater beings can dissolve my bad karma. I don't have the form, but the greater beings do. All right, so now it's very difficult to understand, but it's made very easy to practice. You know, how do I practice it? Like from George Shinshu, I go, Namandavas, Namandavas, who gets it? There, I'm a Jokshinshu Buddhist. So I'm Shingon, you know, Namudashi, Henjo, Kongo, put some incense. I'm a Shingon Buddhist. Nichiren Buddhist. Soto Zen Buddhist. So on, all the same. Very easy to practice. We don't know what it all means, but it's easy to practice. So this is the power of Mahayana Buddhism. You know, it relies upon ritual power, but as I said, you know, it's worked for a long, long time, and it's great for us old guys, but For the younger people, you know, they want meaning. They want something like this, which is why this book sold 3 million copies in Korea. I don't know how many copies it'll sell in English, but I think it's going to be a very popular book. Now, what I want to do with the movies, I want to show two clips. I want to show two clips that illustrate in just kobodashi, these two tendencies. You know, one I call easy to understand Buddhism, like the early Buddhism of Shakyamuni, and the very difficult to understand Buddhism of Mahayana Buddhism. So I think what we find in Mahayana Buddhism is we find both tendencies, you know. The early easy to understand Buddhism is in Mahayana Buddhism as well, except that we tend to not take it too seriously because we focus more on the ritual side. And the ritual side is the one that's hard to understand, the teaching side, you know, the philosophy, the metaphysics, very difficult to understand. Dzogchen Shu Buddhists talk about the inconceivable vow. And every time I hear that word from, you know, Dzogchen Shu Buddhists, you know, oh, you know, Amida's vow is inconceivable. I say, what does inconceivable mean? It means you can't conceive of it. Okay. That means I can't understand it, right? Yes, it's a mystery. Okay? Fine with me. Tell that to my son. It's a mystery. Inconceivable. Every Mahayana group, you know, this is the sort of the thrust of Mahayana Buddhism. It's hard to understand. Hard to understand. It's a mystery. It's profound. I can give you this book, but you can read it and you're not going to understand it because it is so profound. So, in Kobodashi, we find that indeed, as expected, there are going to be ways in which Shingon Buddhism is understood to be very difficult to understand. And the clip that we're going to show has to do with the meeting between Saicho, who is the founder of Tendai Buddhism, and Kukai, who has now, both of them have gone to China. They've come back. And Saicho recognizes that Kobodashi is the real master of esoteric Buddhism of Mikyo. And Saicho wants to learn it, you know, because he wants to learn, you know, the power of the ritual. He wants to learn about the profundity of the teaching. And he recognizes that Kobodashi is the real master. And so Saicho goes to Kobodashi and says, you know, teach me about esoteric Buddhism. Lend me some of your books. And Kobodashi does. But it reaches a point where now Saicho really wants to, you know, get everything, you know, give me the highest ordination. You know, can you do that? You know, I want to borrow this book, you know. And Kobodashi is finally pushed to the point where he has to say, you know, no, you know, or yes, but you know, you need to work at it for much longer. You gotta do it for 3 years. Now, this is the founder of Tendai. You know, just like him, he's the founder of Shingon, and he's telling the founder of another denomination, you know, you gotta study with me for longer before I can give you more of our secret. All right, so this clip is this meeting between Saicho and